Incredible Michaelites Webinar 19. And today again, we have got a great set of the Incredible Michaelites on our panel. So we have got Mr. Chandan Sinha, 1973. He is currently the nominee director of State Bank of India. We have got Mr. Ajay Narayan Jha, 1975, former finance secretary. We have got Kumar Vinay Pratap, 1980, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Home. So before we start with this webinar of the Incredible Michaelites, as you know, there are three sessions to it. One is Amber Sir, Amber Banerjee Sir. Welcome Amber Sir first. So Amber Sir will take you to the school stories with all the three Incredible Michaelites. And then we'll go to the anecdotes and the school stories. And at last, we'll have a teacher who will come to wish us all on this platform. So we'll have a small AV, which would play, which will show about St. Michael's on a whole. And then we'll move to Amber Sir on the school story part. So this is the AV. Yes, Amber sir, over to you.
Thank you, Nishant. A hearty welcome once again to this session of the Incredible Michaelites. And as they say, school times, yes, school times do come to an end, but school memories last forever. And that's exactly what Nishant Dayal is trying to do through this Incredible Michaelites webinar, so that we relive the school memories. So Incredible Michaelites welcomes Mr. Chandan Sinha, 1973 batch, Mr. Ajay Narayan Jha, 1975, and Kumar Vinay Pratap, 1980. All Incredible Michaelites in the sense that what they achieved in life, but then as everyone says, and as you know, all three of them reminded us that all Michaelites are basically incredible. Yes. So welcome to all three of you. A hearty namaskar to the three of you. So as is our custom, we'll begin with, well, the senior most member over here. All right, 1973 batch, Chandan. And then we move on to Ajay and then finally to Vinay. Right? So with your permission, Ajay and Vinay, shall I therefore begin with Chandan?
Please.
Thank you. Right, Chandan. So, yes, hip hip hurray hone do, right? Aur khel ka maza lene do. So, khel ka maza to bahut liya hum logon ne when we were in school. It was all really fun time. It was study time. It was academics, co-academics, sports time. Chandan, you came, I'm sure, from Xavier's, all right? To St. Michael's as a part of that merger program. And I'm sure you also remember that Father Murphy had been transferred in 1968 to St. Xavier, Jaipur. Okay. And we, the hostlers, had actually, you know, arranged a farewell gift, you know, for him, which was a black cassock, the order. But then when this merger thing came, I guess the order came from above, that it was Father Murphy and Father Murphy alone who would be able to handle this somewhat sensitive, difficult merger. St. Xavier's, 770 students, and suddenly, you know, we'll be around 2,000, okay, in one, just within a span of 1 month. So Chandan, welcome to you. And how was the feeling? I mean, like when you came, and especially when you went into the senior class, Father Murphy was no more, and Father Harland, after a small gap, you know, took over. But of course, you were too much of a senior to bother about these things, because I'm sure you must have been very engrossed in your studies and, you know, the senior Cambridge. But then, yes, it was quite a change. So how did you see that? And of course, new teachers also joining hands with some of our old teachers. So how did you react to that? Let us, you know, just take us through those wonderful memories. Chandan, over to you. It's all yours.
Okay, thank you, Amber. So, you know, just to put things in the proper perspective, it's, first of all, it's a very humbling experience to be, you know, called incredible. I think, as you said, but you rightly said, you know, the entire school was incredible. And surely it's a, you know, just a sequence, you know, who comes before, who comes later. So that is one. And obviously an excellent initiative, Nishant and you, and probably born out of the COVID, you know, circumstances. But then, you know, good ideas come during, you know, difficult times. So a great initiative, really, you know. Of course, I watched a few, I have not watched all. And all that I can say is, you know, I've heard some of the incredible Michaelites, and, you know, I kind of know few of them. So I can see the gap, you know, there's a huge gap between, you know, some of them who've come before and, you know, where I stand. And I always felt that incredible is also about the distance you cover from, you know, where you start, you know. So given the kind of start one had, so I personally, I don't think I have, you know, in a sense, overperformed, you know. This is what you should have delivered, given the kind of school and, of course, college you went to. So, you know, it's just a kind of, you know, feeling which I had. And the other thing which I did mention to you just before the program, that we also have, you know, the, you know, incredible people in the unconventional world, the people who are not, you know, into employment or profession, but, you know, basically entrepreneurs of that sort, you know. So perhaps, you know, we are missing some of them. And at least those who are from, you know, this background would like to know a little more about the other guys, you know, you've done so well, and we know a few of them for sure.
So, yeah, and as you yourself said, Nishant himself is one of them.
Yes, I did say that. So, yeah, of course. And then, of course, then I reflect back, and when I looked at others, then I, you know, I kind of felt that I didn't really do anything very extraordinary in school. So let me be honest about it. But I had incredible classmates, you know, really incredible classmates who excelled in academics or sports or extracurriculars. And few of them were actually uniformly good in all. And I have always kind of looked up to the guys who could perform on stage, you know, either they spoke well, they sang well, or acted very well. So, you know, that for me, you know, any day seems to be much better than, you know, just being, you know, good at studies. So I really kind of, you know, think of that. And if I remember right, I think Mr. Robin Francis, if he would have probably confirmed that my school yearbook description just, you know, said about that he was a solid student or something like that. It was just maybe a line of that. So nothing more, nothing less. Now, of course, you know, about the transition from Xavier's to Michael's, it was a bit traumatic for me because I moved, because my brother was there. So I had to move, you know, 2 years ahead of time, you know. So I don't really move with my classmates. I moved, you know, all by myself. And then I was, of course, in a very alien classroom. And at that stage, you know, it's very awkward, you know, losing out friends and, you know, trying to make new ones. But
okay,
you know,
okay, I'd forgotten this, that yes, if you had a sibling, elder sibling, then you were asked to leave your classmates and move, you know. Right. Okay, yeah, so that's wonderful. I mean, that's a wonderful piece of, I think, memory, because I'd completely forgotten about this. Yeah,
so, yeah, So you really, you got out of your comfort zone and you were there. But the guys in Michaels were pretty good, you know. So subsequently, it was an advantage because I knew some of them, you know, even before my other friends joined much later. And some of my closest friends are actually Michaelites, you know, not just, you know, people who have studied with me. That was one transition. But there's one thought which was there in our minds at those days, you know, about moving from Xavier's to Michael's. So it was a kind of a misconception in our minds that, you know, Xavier's would become higher secondary, and higher secondary to us meant, you know, at that point of time that it would become a Hindi medium school. And we were kind of, you know, stuck on doing senior Cambridge, you know, as if it was something which is, you know, kind of, you know, a step above, a couple of steps above. It was completely wrong. But, you know, that is how I think, you know, when we discussed amongst ourselves, you know, we kind of, and there was a lot of talk about Hindi medium, you know, the state itself, you know, becoming, you know, Hindi dominant kind of schooling. So maybe in that context, we had this, you know, feeling in our minds. But most of us moved because the management of Xavier's was moving there, you know, Father Murphy was moving there. So it was almost like, you know, going out there. So, of course, in Xavier's, I was in the hostel, and subsequently in Michael's also, I was in hostel for a year at least. So, of course, principals did matter a lot. Father Murphy was a big man, of course, well, very well known, and of course, very big shoes to fill, actually, even for Father Harland subsequently. And I guess in the initial phase, most of the discussions would have been, you know, kind of, you know, comparing one with the other. You know, it happens in all circumstances. So that must have happened. And I'm sure some of us probably would have started looking towards Father Cox for, you know, kind of guidance or something like that, you know. So he was somebody who you kind of identified with. But again, my memory is not very strong on this. I'm just trying to figure out probably this have gone through, you know. But one thing, you know, for hostlers, actually the hostel superintendent was, you know, was a real, I would say, administrator, you know, because for the most part, you were, you know, under the supervision of, you know, say Father Ribeiro, who was there in Xavier's. And in Michael's, I remember it was Brother Itu, you know.
Brother so
both
Itu, were, yeah.
You know, yeah, both were pretty kind of strict, you know, people. And they're moving around with a cane in their hands, you know. So those days, you know, it was okay, you know, you could cane somebody and you could, you know, get hit.
But then in their own way, if you remember, in their own way, they're charming people, because one with a lot of passion for music and Brother Itu with a lot of passion for, you know, sports, you know, tennis and badminton and so on.
Yeah. Yes. And one thing I kind of remember, you know, whatever our age be, you know, we were very self-respecting kind of, you know, students, in the sense that, you know, there used to be always the issue of, you know, whatever, Brother Itu or somebody, you can't, you know, kind of punish me in front of juniors, you know. So this used to be a big thing, you know. Suppose you were kind of admonished or punished, and, you know, the people used to react, you know, you can't do it in front of, you know, juniors, you know, you call me into your room, you do what you want. That is something which I kind of, you know, stuck, you know, and you always had minor skirmishes with, you know, the hostel superintendent, you know, at that age, people are rebellious, you know, so you don't like rules, you try and do something little, you know, on the side. So those were some of the memories, at least, you know, to start with. And of course, as I said, Father Murphy's funeral, I still is in my mind, you know, I don't know, half of Patna would have turned out for his, you know, funeral. It was
very true.
So I'll stop here. And then.
Yeah. Thank you, Chandan. Thank you so much. It was a wonderful analysis. I mean, like, memories were very beautifully, and I would say very scientifically analyzed by you. Okay, thank you, Chandan. All right, now we move over to Ajay. Ajay, taking this, you know, carrying this forward, because you were also, you know, you followed Chandan because you belong to the 1975 batch. So you also would have had, yes, Father Murphy bidding us all subtly, you know, a goodbye. Of course, we had just passed out because our batch, 1971 batch, was admitted by Father Murphy, and we were the last batch to be, you know, sent off, or what used to be called the recognition day or the recognition evening, So in the last batch to be recognized, and it used to be a wonderful, nostalgic, solemn affair. So Ajay, I'm sure you will carry from where Chandan has left and talk a little about the teachers, about, you know, like, you know, who with whom you've had some wonderful memories, or you remember them, you know, very sentimentally and very thankfully. Right. So over to you, Ajay. All yours now.
Thank you. I must thank Nishant and you for having invited me, and also for this wonderful initiative. We always used to have Michael's old boys meets in our respective cities. Delhi had a very vibrant, still has a very vibrant old boys association. We used to meet at least twice a year, but this is something pan-India, pan-global. All compliments to you, Nishant, and everybody who's behind this. And well, taking off from where Chandan left and what you asked, Michael's was like a second home for me. You know, I came in class four in St. Xavier's, spent 8 years, 2 years in St. Xavier's, and then another 6 years in St. Michael's. 8 months in a year, you are in the hostel with your schoolmates, classmates, other friends. So it was more like a home for us. And that's something one always cherishes, you know, the time spent there, very fond memories. Deep values were ingrained in us in those formative years. Abiding friendships. You still have your best friends from amongst your schoolmates. So that's something one always cherishes and looks forward to. And whenever you meet a Michaelite, whether he's from your time or later or earlier, so that bonding comes, you know, in you. Just a little word on this comparison between Father Murphy and Father Harland. Well, I always found, I mean, they were two very different personalities. Father Murphy had a very, very checkered history, almost 20 years plus as principal of St. Xavier's and then St. Michael's. Whole of Patna, whole of Bihar knew him. You know, he was like a, you know, like a fatherly figure for us, like small kids. But one thing very interesting I found in him, that he had a very discerning eye. Although, I mean, you know, I was in class 6, 7, interacting rarely with him. But when my parents would come to visit, you know, once in a while from Munger, where they lived, to see me in the hostel, they would meet him, and then he would tell them exactly what I was doing in my class, in outside class, in the hostel. So that sense of observation about each child was something very unique in him, and something which, I mean, we all try to learn later in life to pick up from their habit. Harland, of course, came under that huge shadow, and in all fairness to him, he tried very hard. He was a very different personality, and he also ran into a lot of changes that started taking place from 1974. You had to close down the hostel. 75, we were the last class to be in the hostel. The hostel changed, closed. You had a lot of hostels mushrooming all over where students left. So you had a depleted strength all the next 2 years. So, I mean, the school itself was going through a churn. The JP movement had started. Patna was closed for several months. The school was disrupted. So all fairness, Harland, I think, at least till I was there, he tried very hard and very gamely, and all credit to him for having kept the flag flying high. As far as memories goes, well, I have many memories, many, many memories. So it's too short a time to really...
Yeah, but share one or two eventful ones. Yeah, or, you know, yeah, the teacher that you would like to mention.
No, Itup, brother. Itup was a personality who influenced us the most. As kids, we were literally scared of him, because if he saw you, you know, doing something wrong, and you have had it, you know, he would give you the best of whatever was there in his room to whack the hell out of you. So Itup, we were mortally scared of him. But as we sort of grew up, we grew up along with him, and he also started sort of... the relationship changed with him. And one thing very unique about him I used to find was that he had a very ingenious way of punishing people who did not do well in their weekly tests. So he would ask them to cut grass in baby field, you know, or in some field. So I had a classmate who, I think in 1970 or 71, he cut grass throughout the first semester, you know, in school, till I think he left the school after having failed successively in exams.
So that was quite a study in contrast, Ajay. I mean, Father Murphy giving exemptions to the students who did so well in the weekly test. And here was a brother into asking children to cut the grass of the baby. Yes,
two contrasting examples.
Yeah, wonderful. That's excellent.
So there were kids who would get exemption through in all the subjects, you know. So you were in awe of them, you know. But what really fascinated me all along was sports and games, and you know that is what was more inspirational than academics. And Jeff DeCosta was a hero for us. Jeff DeCosta, because he was not only in charge of games, but he has such a discerning eye about talent, and he would select and choose people who are really talented for various, you know, events and games. And I was fortunate enough to play for school both as in the junior team when we came from St. Xavier's and played St. Michael's and held on to the rather, you know, they had
yes,
a much
yes. better team them, yes.
Yeah. hockey and football, but we held our own. So Jeff had that caliber in him to pick out the right person, and he always remained a hero for me, you know, till I passed out. Another person I always remember very fondly is John James. He was our was in charge of the infirmary, and I was quite a sickly child in many ways, falling ill quite often. So John James was like I used to be under his tutelage for several days in any semester. And he had those pink liquids and white liquids and powders, which he would, and the throat paint, he would sort of scrub it on your throat. And whenever we were in the infirmary, the gossip used to be about his affair with Mrs. Callaghan, who was next door. Then, of course, Patnaik, Bernard Patnaik, his wife. Patnaik, incidentally, a very good football player till sort of he grew in size.
Yeah, and a lovely singer and guitarist, if you remember.
Yeah, he was a superb guitarist.
Yeah.
And he would play the guitar to Ranjit Vincent's singing, I think. Mm. And Richard Shah, who was a year senior to us, they used to sing very well. And Mr. and Mrs. Rosario, they lived in a small room somewhere near on way to the baby field. Mrs. Cowell, of course, was a legend. A lot of classes before us and after us.
Oh, yes.
But person who I always recall with some fondness was Mrs. Thomas, because she was our matron when we came to the hostel in class 6 in St. Michael's. And it was an alien environment. And she looked after us really well. Very motherly figure, very gentle. She would look after your buttons were broken or not, your shoes were polished, your belt was in shape. So Mrs. Thomas, and much later, I think she invited us when we were in senior school for a meal in her house, because I didn't do science. So Mr. Thomas was not very well known to me. So that's another thing which I recall with fondness. Then, of course, the highlight always used to be bun bean chip chops, the meal which we used to get in school
On Wednesdays and Saturdays.
And everybody looked forward to eating. I mean, who ate more chops than the other? There used to be a competition. The English movies which followed. So it was wonderful. These are some of the memories. English movies were rare those days. In Patna also, I don't think any theater screened those movies, which the school used to bring from.
Very true, very true, very true.
ERA, as it was called.
Yeah, Educational Recreational Activity. Yeah.
They, of course, my most abiding memories also are of these inter-Jesuit football tournaments.
Uh-huh.
Being on the train to Jamshedpur, Darjeeling, and, you know, all over.
Hazaribagh.
Yeah. Get crammed by many of the better teams, particularly the Calcutta teams would tram us, you know, but still it was good fun going just and the excitement which went with it.
True.
But I just wanted to flag one more thing, which was actually a transformative experience, was the 1975 floods, which came, I think, sometime in August 75 or so. And the school, although there's no water inside the school, but the school became the camp for the entire neighborhood around us. And that's where one saw the real world, you know, the distress, the scarcity, the fight for food as helicopters dropped those packets. Our mess, our in the dining hall, we used to get our meal. You know, the fathers made care, took a lot of care to give it to us. But when you see it, you know, around you, so much of hunger and distress, that sort of was made a lot of impact. That was a lot of impact on me, at least. I felt very strongly after that about. What was around us and what society really was, because we lived a very secluded life for 8 months in a year. We went home, which was more like a holiday, and then you go and just see, you have fun basically. So this was the first real exposure to the world as it existed.
Yeah, so, thank you. Thank you, Ajay. Thanks a ton. Because especially talking about the 1975 floods, because that really puts everything in perspective. Because St. Xavier's in the 60s, you know, was more like a lovely island, okay? And, you know, you are on the ivory tower. St. Michael's was, you know, a little closer to the more rural sort of a setting with Dikha, Kurji, you know, those houses. And St. Xavier's was right there in the heart of the city, with the DM's house to the left. And So it was, yes. So that way, yes. I mean, very nicely expressed, Ajay. And I'm very thankful to you. Absolutely, beautiful. Okay, so now we move over to Vinay. All right, Vinay. Yes, if you have something that, you know, these two guys have left for you, that's number one. And secondly, yes, talk about, you know, your personal memories, your friends, and some of the teachers whom you would, you know, remember. And thanks, Ajay, for remembering the non-academic teachers, you see, because Mr. Jeff DeCosta, Mr. John James, and, you know, Brother Ritu. So, but then, you know, Vinay, you are free to remember anyone and anybody. You are free to remember even not a name if you want. All the best.
Thank you. I'd like to start by thanking Nishant and you and my co-panelists. I'm really fortunate to share this webinar with Mr. Jha. He was Secretary of Expenditure, and I attended many meetings. I was he used to chair what is called the Public Investment Board, the PIB. So all government expenditures would be rooted through, that was the appraisal mechanism. And he used to chair that, and I used to come as the Department of Economic Affairs representative. And he was he used to conduct the meetings in such a calm and collected manner. So it was an inspiration. And then I saw him in one of the Michael's meet. And then I realized he's one of us. So, really thankful to sir and really privileged to share this webinar with him. I came from Notre Dame, so I was in the school from 74 to 82. I also visited the school when Father Murphy died. We used to be in Notre Dame, and then I didn't know what was happening, but I do remember that I had visited the school and paid my respects to Father Murphy. And let me start by saying that the motto of the school is for God and country. And that is what has guided me throughout. And I'll talk about this in my professional, whatever, professional life. But then among the teachers, I was in the arts group. So I had Mr. Lal, S.S. Lal, who was my history teacher. And we used to, he was a unique character. We used to make a lot of fun. But then it was also true that my love for history, like he was the one who ingrained this love. And I still enjoy going to these forts. I still enjoy it. And I scored, I topped the school in history in my 12th grade, mainly because of him. And he used to mark the answer scripts by the length of the answers you have. And he used to tell us a story about a student who had written a story in the answer script, and he sort of noticed it, and he reduced the marks. And then we had Henry Francis. He used to teach us Hindi. And unka favorite phrase tha, 40% was the pass marks. So 39 pe latka dunga. So that used to be, he would use it very often. Then we had Marie McDonald. She used to teach us history, geography. Geography.
Yeah.
That I think was in sixth grade. And like to impress the teachers, sometime or the other, you carry the bags of these teachers from the classroom to the staff room. And I had a cousin, Arun Agrawal, who was in a 2 year senior to me in school. And they used to be in, on the second or third floor. And I was just carrying Miss Mary McDonald's bag one of the days. And they used to, they made so much fun along with his friends that, and that was one memory that I have. Then Miss Marie McDonald also was quite punctilious in the sense how you would pronounce the terms, the mannerisms. These are some of the things that I learned from her. Among the friends, hostels have these stories. So I was a day scholar. I used to cycle to school from Patliputra colony to and through Digha, and that was not a very lovely sight, but the I had a friend called Vipul who was in Mrs. Goff's hostel, and he was what every child should be, in the sense good in studies, elocution, vice president of the students' council, and these, as pointed out Mr. Jha, the relationships that you develop in the school time last forever. They are your best friends. So they used to be Sanjay Kant, who would be in the Patliputra colony, and we used to go around in the bicycle in the evening visiting each other. We used to I was an ordinary student, nothing to write home about. So, but played a little bit of cricket, table tennis, etc. That's about it. But the lasting memory is the values that one got from the school, the motto that the school had for God and country, and that's what has guided me throughout. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinay. Thank you so much. And yes, since you talked about, you know, I mean, like you and Ajay, you talked about Miss Marie improving our pronunciation. So we had teachers, Nishant, Mr. Thomas used to, you know, remind us, come on, it is not potassium, it is potassium. It is not calcium, it is calcium. All right. Now, that's the sort of teachers, you know, we had. And nowadays, you know, if you get some good English teachers, they keep on complaining, oh my God, whatever we try to do that has been undone by the social science teacher or by the science teacher, and in particular, the mathematics teacher. All right, so though, I mean, St. Michael's, therefore, was, you know, it was so different. And you also spoke, Ajay, about Mr. Bernard Patnaik. Nishant, his favorite song with the guitar was, you know, I'll just render two lines. Bohe zara khafa khafa. Right? Yeah. Oh. That was his favorite song. Am I right, Ajay?
That's right. That's right. And he would sing that come September thing tune on the guitar also. Often.
Yeah, this was from Joy Mukherjee and Sarah Banu's Shagir. Okay, Nishan. So thank you. Thank you, the wonderful trio, for taking us down some very, very pleasant memories. And one thing that stands out, incredible you are or you aren't, there's one thing which is there. All the Michaelites that we have actually spoken to were incredibly humble, polite, and friendly, and grateful to the alma mater. Over to you, Nishant.
Thank you, sir. So today, again, we had a very different flavor of St. Michael's nostalgic moments shared by everyone. And as we speak today, today is exactly the 8th month of the Incredible Michaelites, which started on June 7th, 2020. So we'll start with Chandan Bhaiya, 1973. Chandan Bhaiya, it was the former executive director, Reserve Bank of India, and currently he's the nominee director, Board of State Bank of India. So Bhaiya, straight away, we'll go to the first questions of the professional end, and that is, we want to know about the your role as panelist on cybersecurity at the international events hosted by Bank de France, SWIFT, and Digital Money by Citi, please.
Okay, I'm not mute. So actually, you know, for us, it comes with the job, you know. So in my portfolio, I had at that point of time, IT and the payment systems. So actually, you know, these conferences or these opportunities actually arose out of that particular, you know, portfolio which you had, the departments which were kind of overseeing. So one, of course, related to the cybersecurity part. And if you remember, you know, a few years back, there was, you know, quite a bit on, you know, cybersecurity. Even today, it's a big thing. So we had this Bangladesh, you know, incident where, you know, they lost about 100 million or so. And it was also subsequently followed by, I think, one of our banks, Union Bank. They lost, but they recovered. So cybersecurity was actually growing big. As IT grows, the cybersecurity part also grows. And then, of course, you need to understand that, you know, the cybersecurity, you know, what you need to do is at the institutional level. So maybe at the bank level, then you need to do it at the sector level, because, you know, say, for example, a bank is connected with other banks, you know, and other market infrastructure like trading corporations, stock exchanges. So again, you have to resolve that, you know, at the sector level, and of course, at the national level also, because there's a oversight, what, you know, what is happening. And we have a, you know, institution in Delhi, CERT-IN, which actually, you know, caters to that, both sectorally and for the country as a whole. And finally, you need to have what is, you know, at the international level cooperation, because most of the actually attacks originate outside, you know, and there are state actors who, some of them who indulge in them. And these conferences, especially the one which was there in France, Paris, was relating to about international cooperation. So basically, you know, each country and, you know, of course, India, you present, you know, your case, what, you know, how you are trying to manage it. And you look for some kind of a cooperative arrangement. It could be bilateral. Ideally, it has to be multilateral, because otherwise the problem cannot be solved. But even if you have certain bilateral arrangements, you know, you get access to information. Say a bank in, say, for example, France has been subject of certain kind of attack. If that information is shared, then perhaps, you know, the banks in India, if they are alerted, could prevent that kind of attack. So that is, you know, one kind of thing. The other is ultimately, whatever has happened in, you know, kind of these attacks, actually nobody has really been found or got arrested or punished. It's because, you know, you can't find them. Even if you find them, they are in a country over which you have no control. So this international conference, you know, it's one of those which generally address, you know, cooperation at the international level. And at least at some bilateral, you know, level, you could have certain arrangements of information sharing, as also some technical, you could get technical advice or in fact, technical help also. It could be other ways from India to those countries, or it could be in a reverse manner. So cybersecurity was one. And then similarly, the same thing was played out in that Cybers thing, which is an international a conference on banking and finance, which is done every year by the SWIFT organization. Those who are from banks probably will know, whether it doesn't really matter. So you got an opportunity there to showcase, you know, about India's preparedness to combat, you know, cyber crime, so to speak. And you get a lot of, you know, feedback. And of course, you get to listen to others, how they are, you know, dealing with it. And that finally, what you talked about, you know, about the Citi kind of digital currency conference, which was there in Washington, that, of course, focused on the digital currency, you know. So even this current budget has talked about India will start exploring a centralized digital currency. Some countries have gone a little ahead of us, like China, for example. And but my particular, you know, talk there was actually showcasing India's, you know, progress which we have made on the payment system. So on the payment system, actually, India is far, far ahead of several other countries because, you know, there's a lot of government which has done, there's a lot of private sector which has done, the Thai spirit which is there in Bangalore, the Jam Trinity which is there. And of course, the Reserve Bank itself has enabled a lot of you know, innovation and using NPCI and, you know, people like that. So actually, we are quite state of the art, you know, and a lot of, you know, people and other countries want to listen to the Indian story. And even, you know, countries have asked for, I recall some technical help from India. So, you know, this is something, you know, which comes with the job, you know, so we're doing it and those opportunities are there. And then you kind of go and further them during the time you are there. So I would actually leave it at that and not go beyond anything more.
No. It's very, very important thing what you have shared, sir, because today it's all about all the financial frauds which are happening across. So this is a very informative thing. So Chandan, I'll again come to you for the second part of the question. I will straight away go to Ajay Bhaiya. So Ajay Bhaiya, former finance secretary, and former member 15th Finance Commission and IAS Manipur cadre. Bhaiya, we have learned from your profile that you wrote a paper on India's election management bodies. And India is a country which is very, we are very interested in the election management thing. And you have also served this body for some part of your career. Would you like to share some stories on the election commission and your stint on that?
I spent a very long time in the election commission. In actually 6 years, I spent 1999 to 2005. And I came at a time when the general elections for the 1999 Lok Sabha was announced. If you recall, Prime Minister Vajpayee had lost the vote of confidence by one vote, and elections had to be conducted very quickly. And I was in my cadre in Manipur, and I had been recalled. I opted to go to Election Commission at that point of time, and then I served for 6 years over there. This was not only a very politically turbulent phase, but it also was a phase where the Election Commission had to come out of the legacy of Mr. Session and establish itself as an institution which was not based on one single individual. Mr. Session actually had transformed the election system in India. Remarkable contribution he has. But then it was a one-man show all along, but a lot of things had to be institutionalized, and that was the period when this was to be done. But unfortunately, we had two quick elections, 1997, we had 1998, 1996, 97, 98, and 99, I mean, three elections were held in a span of less than 5 years. So the phase where I worked in the ECI was the phase of consolidation. And we had a lot of things which we could do in that period. One was this computerization of the entire electoral rolls. The photo identity cards which you use today was actually developed during Mr. Sessions' time, but it had been left unfinished. We had to complete it in a manner where it would be it could reach all the citizens. And the photographs were such that they could be discernible, not like the past where the photos were of somebody else and the card belonged to somebody else. So all those type of transformatory changes had to take place. But the single most difficult task for us was EVMs, the electronic voting machines. It actually got designed and manufactured way back in 1980, but then it got stuck in some litigation and the law had to be changed, which came about only in 1996 or 97. And I started actually working on the first use of EVMs in the country. We did the state elections in Goa. That was a small state as a trial basis. And ultimately, in 2004, it was, the whole country had was using EVMs, which itself was a major challenge because the schedule of manufacturing, training, supply of EVMs to the states was planned in a manner where they would reach everywhere by May or June of 2004. But Prime Minister Vajpayee preponed the Lok Sabha elections by almost 7 months. So the whole time schedule had to be squeezed within a period of 2 months to conduct this biggest exercise. 600,000, 6 lakh polling stations multiplied by 10. That is the number of people you have to train on the machines. You have to have technicians manning each of these polling stations to take care of any eventuality. You have to have reserve machines. The police has to be trained to act in a way where the supply of machines are not hindered in any manner. So, I mean, Election Commission itself was a fascinating experience. And in between, we also had one of the most challenging elections of Jammu and Kashmir in 2002, which was being held after a gap of almost 8 or 10 years that polls were being held in J&K. And J&K in 2002 was, if you can recall, was like a tinder box, you know, with all sorts of insurgency and terrorism and threats, and you had people boycotting it in large parts of the valley. So it was a fascinating experience, and I really enjoyed this phase of my career.
Fantastic, yeah, superb, great to hear about this. So I'll come back to again on the second part of it, and I'll straight away go to Vinay Bhaiya. So Vinay Bhaiya, Joint Secretary, EUT, Ministry of Home, and I am from Lucknow. I can see a multifaceted with Vinay Bhaiya. He has also been a visiting professor to ISB, I am Ahmedabad, I am Lucknow, National Academy, and also he's written a book on PPP in infrastructure, managing the challenges. Bhaiya, we would like to know, with all your experiences and your service, what has been the most challenging position you have served?
Actually, too, I am from the Indian Economic Service. I am not in the part of the hallowed portals of the Indian Administrative Service. So I gotten picked up in Mr. Vajpayee's Prime Minister's office. I was Deputy Secretary in the Prime Minister's office from 2002 to 6. So I had occasion to serve for 2 years in Mr. Vajpayee's PMO and 2 years in Dr. Manmohan Singh's PMO. This was extremely challenging because I'd just come from a foreign posting in 2001, which is like a paid holiday. I know my foreign service colleagues would not agree to it, but I happen to be in Washington, D.C. as Third Secretary for Economic Affairs, and it didn't stretch you at all. So coming from there and then to join the PMO, where the hours were 12 hours plus every day, it was quite challenging. I used to handle transport infrastructure. So the Ministry of Roads, Railways, Shipping and Civil Aviation, among others, as also the Ministry of Coal. And Mr. Shibu Soren, who was the Minister of Coal, had to go to jail. And the Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, used to handle this portfolio himself. So I had the occasion to help out on some policy making, including the electronic auction of coal. There used to be a notified price of coal, which is much below the market clearing price. So, and there used to be a rent, so to say, in the black market. And the coal companies were sick because the amount of revenues they were getting is much lesser than what is possible. The middlemen were making all the money. So companies like the Eastern Coalfields Limited, the Bharat Coking Coal Limited, were sick right from the beginning, and their jobs were at stake because the government can't fund losses throughout. So by introducing electronic auction of coal, you at least some of this surplus, which went to middlemen, started coming to these companies, which became profitable for the first time. Similarly, the competitive bidding of coal block, and you would have heard of that famous story about the Hindalco incident and Dr. Manmohan Singh's PMO. I was handling all this paperwork. So, but we managed to introduce competitive bidding of coal block, so that some of the surplus which used to go to middlemen started coming to the government. So this was one of my most challenging assignments. Another one was, and that was my dream job, was the was as Joint Secretary Infrastructure Policy and Finance in the Ministry of Finance. I had done my PhD from the University of Maryland, so I was really fortunate to be able to practice what I had to, what I had learned in my PhD. And I, with this background of the school, like value systems that the school got you, and then having worked in working in a dream job, it gave me a lot of opportunities as well as challenges. But again, the entire policy framework for the infrastructure sector in India, I had occasion to contribute to that, and that was very satisfying and challenging. That's it. Thank you.
Fantastic, Bia. So I will again come back to you, Vinay Bia. So let me again go back to Chandan Bia for this. So Chandan Bia, we would like to, can you just elaborate your professional journey to the level of nominee director of SBI?
Okay, no, I'll just talk about this directorship. It's a an occupational hazard for an RBI official, you know. If you think, you know, from a governance perspective, RBI should not be board of a, you know, a regulated or a supervised entity. But as the statute stands, you know, it's, you have to be there. And I think, you know, the government wants the RBI to continue. So the RBI viewpoint is different. We shouldn't be there. But, you know, as things stand, you know, this is the status quo kind of continues. This state bank thing, you know, was in 2016 when I was an executive director. And normally this position used to be occupied by, you know, deputy governor of Reserve Bank of India. And Mr. Dr. Urjit Patel had, you know, been elevated to the governor, you know, position. And then I think for some reason he nominated me, could have nominated whatever. So for some reason I got nominated, and then it continued, and it has continued beyond my, you know, superannuation from the Reserve Bank of India. Perhaps it's more of a strategic thing because the RBI in a sense is able to distance itself, you know, to the extent possible, you know, from the supervised entity. And I believe there is some kind of an agreement or understanding with the government and the RBI that a few would be from the retired side and others would be, you know, from the in-service RBI officials. So again, this is all second-hand information. But, you know, point is this position kind of continues. So I've spent, you know, a little over four years now. As I said, it's an occupational hazard, but it's got huge kind of benefits. And especially for somebody like me, because I started my career as a probationary officer in State Bank of India, you know. So it's like coming back a full circle, and at least if nothing else, I have ended up on the board of State Bank of India. And actually, when I joined, quite a few of my batchmates were still in service. So I could reconnect with them. Of course, I was connected, but I could again reconnect with them. So that has been very satisfying for me. And from a central banker's perspective, you know, this is the closest we get to the real sector, you know. As somebody said, you know, we generally, whether school or in the Reserve Bank, you know, you sit in ivory towers, you know, you're quite far from the reality. But here, you know, you get the closest, I would say, for a central banker to the real sector, because, you know, there's a lot of, you know, feedback loop, you know, because the bank is trying, for example, to increase credit and it's not happening, you know. So you could be guessing, you know, whether the demand is not there or the supply is not there, or whether, you know, people are risk averse. So whatever it is, but you get a much better sense, and why it's not happening, that also you get a better sense. So it has its benefits, and we, of course, are required to, you know, as a director, report back. I think even the government directors, we actually report back, you know, saying, you know, what are you seeing and what do you think should be happening. So, you know, again, as I said, you know, these two things are there. And the third thing is, of course, you are amongst, you know, fairly, you know, what should I say, accomplished set of people, you know, so the director, especially in State Bank. So, you know, they are able to get, you know, quite specialized people, you know, on the IT side, you know, on the accounting side, on the finance side. So overall, I would say the trade-off, you know, the risk and the reward, I would say it's a rewarding kind of an assignment. So I'll stop there.
Superb, superb here. So I'll go back again to Ajay Bhaiya on this. So Ajay Bhaiya, it's bureaucracy, it's election commission, it's two times in finance commission, it's union finance secretary. We would like to understand your learning from St. Michael's and preparation, which did shape you for this professional achievement. Do you want to share that?
Yes. See, after St. Michael's, I joined St. Stephen's College for BA in history. And I mean, there were a lot of Michaelites there from before us. And even later, a lot of people from college would come to Delhi University, including St. Stephen's. And of course, it was a national pastime those days to appear for the civil services and try and get into it. And more so in DU and JNU, where which were a lot of centers for joining civil service. So, but my journey really in the civil service begins in Manipur, where which was my cadre, which was my allotted cadre. And it was a bit of a shock initially because it was so diverse, culturally diverse. People were different from us. Food habits were different. You know, it's a very backward place. And when you compared to other states in the country, you felt as if, you know, where exactly was I going in terms of the service. But this is one of the lessons one carried from the school and, of course, college also, that you start appreciating diversity in its different forms. And adaptation and assimilation, which the hostel had taught us, became a very handy tool to adjust in Manipur. which in the 80s and well through the 90s was one of the most difficult places in terms of insurgency, law and order. You know, it was a real challenge for any administrator because there was the people there were in a pincer. You had the insurgents from different from one side, and you had the armed forces, the police, the army, etc., operating on the other side. And the civil administration was right at the center of it. So you're caught on from both sides in a pincer, because people wanted you to protect them from the armed forces, and the armed forces wanted you to help them get into and catch the insurgents. So it was a continuous battle of wits, which one had to live through for a long, long time in the state, whether in the district or whether even in the secretariat, your role was such that you had to push development in such a way that that it reached the people. Another big lesson which one carried from school, of course, thanks to all the teachers, the priests, the fathers who sort of inculcated in us the concept of honesty and probity, truthfulness. You know, these are values which one always cherished, and these were the values which people also liked, I found, in Manipur. Then, of course, there was any bureaucrat, you go through a lot of transfers, postings here, there. But Manipur as a block was a big, big phase of my career. I spent almost half my service career there. Then, of course, election commission. I talked about the election commission, the challenging times I went in, and then the pleasure of serving for 6 years under three very different types of election, chief election commissioners. We had M.S. Gill, who was a very towering personality, James Lingdob, who was from the Bihar cadre, incidentally, and a legend in himself. Then Mr. Krishnamurthy, who was from the Revenue Service, a non-IAS officer, but extremely nice and good person to work with. So that was another phase which was very rewarding. And then my sort of career in public finance started, first at the state level, when I went as back after election commission as finance secretary of Manipur, and then continued in Government of India, two finance commissions, the 14th finance commission where I was secretary. I had a towering personality of Dr. Y.V. Reddy, former governor of RBI, as the chairman. So it's a great learning experience. You learn from such people about how finance should be managed and run. Then, of course, stint in the Ministry of Finance as expenditure secretary, union finance secretary, where you are the purse keeper of the country, and a lot of decisions vest in your hands, basically. Kumar Pratap mentioned about me chairing these public investment board meetings. They're very, very important because they finance projects worth 500 crores and more. And a lot of it rides on these projects, including many which are there, which get a lot of time, get approved by the cabinet, and then get implemented in the field. But you have the satisfaction of at least molding the course of some of these projects towards better implementation and completion. So then you are also the manager of the personnel affairs of public servants, which is the most difficult job to do, because this involves foreign tours, something which in Government of India is so people just strive to get into, go abroad. And then you have to cut down trips for various reasons, or promotions, policy, pay fixations. All these type of things are there, nitty gritty, which again, the responsibility vests in the expenditure secretary. But ultimately the fiscal part of it is actually in his hands to a great extent, because he really drives the way in which the fiscal deficit numbers flow for the country. So it was again a challenging role. Of course, I concluded my stint in public service as member of the 15th Finance Commission. It has just given its report. Basically, a Finance Commission decides on the allocation of shares of states in the central tax revenues. So it's, if you have read, it's around 41%. But then you decide on other parameters also that govern public finance in the country, in terms of expenditures, in terms of mobilization of revenues, in terms of your fiscal roadmap as you go ahead. We have gone through a very, very difficult time, as all of you are aware, over the last 1 year. So how, what will be the roadmap for the next 5 years is what we worked at in the last 2 years. And I hope what we have done is going to be closer to what India will come out with. And hopefully we look forward to better days ahead. So in that sense, that sort of sums up my career, but it's been quite exciting working in the IAS. A lot of changes once in a while in the state as well as in the center, but overall satisfying. And a lot of values learned right from the school days, most important of probity, honesty, truthfulness, still hold good. And that's what one has always cherished. Thanks.
Fantastic. Extremely proud of you, Bhaiya. And today the lower tone of the webinar has been the finance side of it, because everyone has served finance on a level which is very important. So to the last question of the professional achievement, we'll go to Vinay Bhaiya. So Vinay Bhaiya, with all your experiences all across, we would just like to know about your professional achievements, what you want to share on this platform, which goes to all the Michaelites, and they can understand more about things.
Among the professional achievements is this mid-career PhD. It's difficult. I went to the US to do my PhD at the age of 42, just after I completed my stint in the Prime Minister's office, wrote the GRE, and went to the University of Maryland at College Park, which is the NOIDA of Washington, D.C. So the challenge is that all your peers are well settled in life in the US. You subsist on a student budget. So, and you have your family with you. So it doesn't amount for much. So one is that about the financing, because your budget is much smaller than that of your peers, and that creates a little dissonance. Secondly, from working all the time in the Prime Minister's office, you're studying all the time. As government servants, we are not used to studying so much. So it stretched us a lot. It stretched me a lot. But then it was immensely satisfying. I think I learned quite a bit. I got to work at the World Bank in Washington, D.C. Of course, the government of India permitted me to do that. And then I got an opportunity to live my dream, which is the trinity of having studied something and applying that. The topic of my dissertation was privatization of infrastructure. And I come here and get picked up for a job which is Joint Secretary of Infrastructure in the Government of India. So I was living my dream there. And I was very fortunate to have gotten that. And then I was teaching the same subject at the Indian School of Business in Hyderabad. I devised a course and they liked it and they asked me to teach. I taught that for 5 years. So this was probably my professionally my best assignment in the sense of getting this PhD mid-career. Then I also appeared for this exam, the Indian Economic Service. I topped the country in that exam. But not having made it to the IAS left me with a yearning to a quest for knowledge. And that's what I've been trying to do. And combined with the values that one learns at the school level, this creates problems, because you will do what your heart says you must do, no matter what. And that creates problems, because government is a whole team. things have to move, that creates problems. But at the end of the day, you have the satisfaction, I have the satisfaction of having done what my heart said. And if given a second chance as Joint Secretary of Infrastructure, I would do the same thing again. I have no regrets. Thank you.
Superb, yeah, fantastic. Now, as a part of the Incredible Michaelite Blessing Session, we have got Mr. Robin Francis, and we have got three Incredible Michaelites here. Robin sir, pranam. सामने आपके तीन स्टूडेंट हैं.
बहुत अच्छा लगता है, बहुत बार मिलते हैं हम लोग. अब ये लोग तो बहुत बड़ा भी हो गया, हम लोग वहीं के वहीं हैं. We are the same teacher. चंदन को तो हम तो देखते थे बराबर, चंदन सिन्हा वगैरह जो है, और अभी सुने हम लोगों के बारे में तो बहुत अच्छा लगा है. I think they're doing very well, and जो है वो हमारे अपने इंडिया के prominent लोग हो गए.
हाँ जी सर. अजय अजय भैया भी हैं. अजय अजय झा 1975 बैच.
हाँ 75 बैच.
और 1980 बैच से कुमार विनय प्रताप हैं. बट सर का मेमोरी बहुत स्ट्रांग है, और सर अभी भी वो ईयरबुक रखते हैं सबके फोटो वाला. तो वी हैव गॉट, आप सबको एक बार आशीर्वाद दे दीजिए सर.
क्या था ये रियोस्टैट क्या?
आई हैव गॉट कंप्लीट लैब ऑफ फिजिक्स.
जी
आई टीच देम स्टूडेंट कम टीच देम फ्रीली आई शो देम ऑल द एक्सपेरिमेंट.
सर हमने आगे जाकर के भी फिजिक्स पढ़ा, बीएससी एमएससी, लेकिन शायद नहीं करना चाहिए था.
सर ने बहुत कुछ हमको कोशिश की, मीटर गेज, वर्नियर कैलिपर्स, सब कुछ समझाए, लेकिन मेरे को समझ में नहीं आया, आगे जाके छोड़ना पड़ा.
नहीं इतना लैब ये एबर्ट.
उसके बाद फिर सर वो भी था ना बुलेंड का, अलग अलग हीट लाइट साउंड बुलेंड BOULIND है ना बुलेंड का,
तो फट गया है. व्हाट आई नीड ड्यूरल, आई डोंट हैव ड्यूरल. ड्यूरल इज वेरी गुड बुक स्टिल. आई डोंट आई वांट अ कॉपी ऑफ दैट.
फिर कॉलेज में आगे जाके राय चौधरी इंटरमीडिएट फिजिक्स, जनरल फिजिक्स, जनरल फिजिक्स.
Right. Thank you, sir. So we'll come to the end of Incredible Michaelites. And before we finish, I will just take the last word from Chandan Bhaiya.
So this is what I think there has to be a message, or what is
message it? To all the Michaelites alumni on a whole.
Actually, वो सर को देना चाहिए, हम लोग उस लायक नहीं है, बट नंदलेस
लायक है.
एक्चुअली आई वुड से दैट यू शुड बी माइंडफुल ऑफ द लेगेसी व्हिच यू कैरी ऑन योर शोल्डर्स, यू नो, एंड दैट्स क्वाइट अ लोड. सो प्ले बाय द रूल्स एंड फॉरगेट द रेस्ट, यू नो. दैट इज इन शॉर्ट व्हाट आई लर्न फ्रॉम स्कूल, यू नो.
फैंटास्टिक, सुपर. अजय भैया, two lines to the Michaelites and the Incredible Michaelite on the whole, please.
See, all these years, St. Michael's has maintained a brand which is now known at least all over India as well as abroad. I'm sure where it matters, people know about the school. And there's a bonding which exists between us, whether, you know, the moment I, for example, Kumar, the moment I saw him in the old boys meet, you know, our relations, our equations changed completely, dramatically. You know, even meetings, it changed dramatically after that. So this is the spirit which we have to keep alive and going. And what you are doing, Nishant and Ambar Bhai and others behind you, this is exactly what will keep the spirit going. And I hope it remains like this. We keep meeting even if the world opens up as it will, or in due course of time. We should have this going, and that is what will keep us, keep the flames burning, and the school's memories will remain cherished, will remain ingrained in our minds. That that's the only guy.
Fantastic. Vinay Bhaiya, your two lines to the alumni and the Incredible Michaelites on our please.
Values are the most important thing. It might put you back temporarily, but that's the sign of a demonstrated competitive advantage. Practice them, you will be in good stead. Thank you.
Fantastic. So thank you, everyone. So on 28th of February, we'll have the webinar 20, and we'll have Mr. Raj Vikas Verma, 1970. We'll have Mr. Mohanish Verma, 1980. And we'll have Mr. Saket Shukla, 1988. Stay tuned. It's all about Incredible Michaelites, and every Michaelite is incredible. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.